Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father, we thank you for this chance to meet together and to look at your Word, Lord, and we just pray that you would open up our eyes to see and our ears to hear what the Spirit would say this morning. We pray that you use Pastor Izzy. Lord, keep distractions away. Lord, take all the burdens away from us right now that we can put our attention fully on you. We ask that now in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, guys. If you turn in your Bibles to Romans 12, 12. It's an easy one to remember. Romans 12, 12 this morning where we're going to pick up. And we're actually just halfway through a paragraph that Paul has written to the church at Rome. And it began back in verse 9 with the words, let love be without what? Hypocrisy. You ever run into those hypocritical Christians that, you know, I mean, I hate to say it, but they're in the club. And sometimes we wish they weren't because they give the rest of the Christians a bad name. But this is the instructions, what Paul gives to the church at Rome on how do you really, rubber meets the road practically, live your Christian faith in a way that is not hypocritical. Okay, this is the what I call the best breakdown in Scripture that we have that just like puts it into really easy to apply truths to help guard us. I mean, this is for my own good. This particular paragraph in the book of Romans is probably one of the most profound, like life-changing ways to make me impactful for the gospel. You know, we all want to be used for the Lord in a great way, but if we don't practice what Paul writes here, it's really hard for those that are looking at us to really buy into the fact that, yeah, I want to be a Christian, sign me up. I mean, they don't want to sign up if we're living like hypocrites. In fact, I think, I don't know about you, but is it a turnoff to you when you run into one of those hypocritical Christians and they're telling you, you should do as I say, but not as I do? That's hypocritical. You should live like Christ did, but they don't do it. I mean, every Christian I have run into like that, I'm like, get away from me. And I'm a pastor. I know you shouldn't say that, right? But it's like, come on. I don't really want them to get away. I want them to change their attitude and change their behavior. And this is a passage today. We're going to continue this paragraph that we began last week where Paul breaks down step by step, how do you live in a manner that's not hypocritical? How do you really love, like with true godly love, without coming off as a hypocrite? And we saw last week, just for a quick review, if you weren't with us in verse 9, he said, the first thing you do, you abhor what is evil. Hate what's evil. Abhor is not just to hate, but it's to hate so much that you turn away from it. Okay, you're like, ditch out. That is bad, that's evil, get away. Okay, that's abhorring evil. And the second part of that line was, you cling to what? The things that are good. So if you're going to say you're going to love like Christ loves, true godly love doesn't put its affection and its eyes toward evil. It says that's bad. And it turns away from it and to say like, no good. I hate what is evil and I cling to what is good. And then the second instruction was found in verse 10. We be devoted to one another in brotherly love. You know, there's a lot of hypocritical Christians that when it comes to, you know, they say, yeah, I'm a Christian, but I hate that other Christian over there. Wait a minute. Aren't we supposed to be devoted to each other in brotherly love? That doesn't really work. So the next part is we actually have to live this stuff. You know, remember Jesus' commandment. This is my commandment. I give you a new commandment that you do what? Love one another. He didn't make it hard. He just said, this is what you got to do. And then the next part was you give preference to one another in brotherly love. I'm not going to go over these. I'm just giving you the lead into today's part. I don't like pulling stuff out of context. And then the following instruction was you don't lag behind in diligence. In other words, you really get in there and you go for it. Okay, you're diligent at your faith. You try because people can spot it. If you're not diligent about your faith, you're not really applying yourself. They're going to call you on it. You're a Christian. You don't even, you kind of slack. You don't even go to church, you know, or you don't you don't even go to a Bible study. You never even read your Bible. Do you ever pray? they bust you. Because you have to be diligent about the things of your faith. And he, I like how Paul says it, not lagging behind in these things. Okay? But you need to be fervent in your spirit, on fire in your spirit. And the last thing we studied last week is that you need to serve who when it comes to not being a hypocrite? Serve yourself, right? Get it all for yourself. Live for yourself. No, that's what a hypocrite does. He says you have to serve the Lord. You got to be a person who serves the Lord. And people can spot the genuine folks that are not serving themselves but serving the Lord. And in so doing, Jesus said, if you want to be great in my kingdom, learn to be the servant of how many? All. I mean, one of the things the Lord came was he served everybody. And then he says, come follow me. Follow my example. You know, there's a lot of people that need help. And the Lord has led us to be a light in this life that we lead. We can be such a great reflection of Christ's love when we just become servants. That's how we be great in his kingdom. Now today we pick up with that thought, serving the Lord, and we get to the next verse, Romans 12:12, where we read this. It says, now we rejoicing, and one of the translations says, constantly in hope. Rejoicing always in hope. This is something that Christians, I hate to say it, but you ever run into Christians that don't have any joy? By the way, rejoicing is what? What does it mean to rejoice? First, you have to joy once before you can rejoy. Because, I mean, it's really, I know I'm breaking it down to the root word, but literally, rejoice means to revisit joy over and over and over. And we just sang that psalm today, what David sang to the Lord when he cried out to the Lord after he sinned with Bathsheba. He cried out in Psalm 51:10-12. He said, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me, and cast me not away from your presence. He felt God's presence had moved. Not because God moved, but because his sin. You know how the psalmist said, it's my sin that has separated me from thee, O God. You know, if God feels far away, it wasn't him that moved. It's us that got into sin. And that sin breaks off that pipeline, that fellowship that we are designed for with God. And all of a sudden, we feel like, wow, God's really far away. David felt this. The one thing about David, he wasn't perfect. You read the Bible, it tells on him, you know. This is what I know. This is a real holy book. Not some fake thing. You know, in the fake cults, if you read their books, all the people in the books are perfect. They don't have any flaws. They're the like main characters of the story. They're the heroes in their own mind. Whoever wrote the book just made them all perfect. And I'm like, yeah, right. What's the Bible said? There is none perfect, not even how many? Not even one. There's only one that would be able to fulfill the law, and that would have to be God come in the flesh. Or as Christ was called, Emmanuel. Remember when Jesus was born as a baby, the angel said, you shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. He's the only one that was good. But here we have these folks that just make themselves out like they're perfect. Not in the Bible. The guys in the Bible you read, they're flawed. But it shows a God who's powerful, a God who's forgiving, a God who's merciful, a God who can do mighty things on our behalf. And God says of David, he was a man after my own heart. David, though he wasn't perfect and he screwed up, he said, Lord, forgive me. He was quick to repent. And when he repented, he's like, God, I need you to cleanse me, create in me a clean heart. I need you to restore me something. Do you guys remember what he said there in the prayer? Restore unto me what? The joy of my salvation. His joy had gone away. You know, when you get into sin, one of the real telltale signs of Christians that have a lot of joy and all of a sudden their joy is diminished. They come to me, Pastor, I don't have any joy. I'm like, what's your sin? How'd you know? Well, it's kind of like this direct cause and effect thing. You know, you get into sin, your joy goes down. Joy meter pegs to the negative side. And the only thing that I know that can restore that joy is praying to God, who is the author of that joy, the one that gives us the joy. And that joy, how many of you can remember when you first found out that Christ died for all the sins of the world, including yours? I say that because I grew up knowing he died for all the sins of the world, my Catholic upbringing. I thought, yeah. But I always thought in my mind, it's only for the good guys. Because as bad guys, we have to keep going to confession, and we have to keep getting more penance, and we have to keep, you know, going in the box with the priest. And, you know, you don't get this idea that it's for you. You think it's for the good people. At least that's how I, did anyone ever feel like that? You know, like, Christ died, but for the good guys. As bad guys, we weren't, somehow in my mind, I didn't think I was included. But was I included in God's perspective? Sure. And it would take God to open my spiritual eyes to see that I was included in the God so loved the world, is he included, that he gave his only begotten son. That even if Izzy believes me, then I was included. I got to have everlasting life and would not perish. And when that sunk in, how many can remember that day when you learned that truth counted you in the club? That you were into. How'd you feel that day? Man, that was a good day. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm in the club? Me too? And my sins are, like Christ says, they're as far as east is from west. In a straight line. I mean, it is removed from me. My sin's gone. What did the psalmist say? It's cast into the sea. Here, I got visual aid. Look behind me. In the sea of forgetfulness, to the deepest place in the depths of the ocean, God took my sin and removed it from me. Never to be brought up again. Now, I don't know about you, but when I learned that, I was like, this is the best club in the world. I mean, come on. The leader says, you are clean and I have cleansed you. Completely forgiven. What happens to your joy when you learn that? Now, by the way, the kids were asking, what's the difference between joy and happiness? Because don't they just make you feel good, both of them? It's like a synonym. Are they synonyms? I said, no, not really. You know, synonym is like equivalent, right? In English terms, if they say this is the synonym to that, you know, the this word is to that word, that means they're equal. But joy and happiness are not equal. Although they manifest in both of them making you feel good, okay? But the cause of joy and the cause of happiness are, if you look up in Webster's, happiness is the reaction to a circumstance, a positive or, I just forgot the word is. So happiness is really literally dependent on physical circumstance. You have everything going right that day, you're happy. Joy is kind of has the same feeling to it, but it's not caused by your external physical circumstance. It's dependent on an internal spiritual circumstance, and that circumstance is that you have let God cleanse your soul from your sin. Because when you come to know that God forgives you and cleanses you, you get this thing, the joy of your salvation. And it can stick with you. Until you get in sin like David. And then you're crying, oh God, where'd that go? Because that's a really good feeling. But when we go and we willfully sin and we, like David, I mean, he slept with Bathsheba. Then he called for her husband from the front lines. Remember, he's the king. And he said, tell me what's happening at the front lines. Here, have a drink with me. And he was trying to loosen him up a little and say, why don't you go on home? And the guy was so noble, he wouldn't even go home to his wife. He's like, if my buddies are in the field fighting, how can I go to my own bed and be comforted with my own wife? And so he slept on the porch of the king's palace. He didn't even go home. David's like, this isn't working. I'm trying to cover up my mistake here. Because Bathsheba was pregnant now. But he figured, bring the guy home for leave. What's he going to do? I mean, naturally, go home, see his wife, and then everything will be covered up and no one will know, right? Except who knows? God. He's busted. God sent a prophet in Nathan. He went to visit David. He said, you know, David, there was a man. He had, like, great flocks, and he had a neighbor, had one little ewe lamb. There, it was like the family pet. They, so close to me. The lamb slept, you know, in the house with the, like, you know, how your dog sleeps in the bed by you. You know, this lamb was that close in the family. And the rich guy had a visitor, and he didn't want to slay one of his flock to feed the sojourner, the visitor. So he went over and took the little ewe lamb from the neighbor's only lamb and slayed it and fed it to the visitor that came. David got really mad. That guy deserves to die. He's going to have to pay back sevenfold. And you know what the prophet did, right? Went to him and said, you are the man. You could have had any woman. You're the king. And you went and took another man's ewe lamb. You took his precious bride. Shame on you. David was busted. And then we see God convicts him, and he writes that beautiful psalm, create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit. Lord, fix me up. And that part, cast me not away from your presence. And take not your Holy Spirit. I need your Holy Spirit, Lord. And restore. Now, I love this. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation. That had gone away. Some guys are not spiritually sensitive to this. When they get into sin, they don't even notice that their joy is going down and down. And then you run into them, and they're like the cranky Christians. You know, you ever met a cranky Christian? This is not letting love be without hypocrisy. We should not be known as the most cranky people on the planet. What's the matter with you? I'm a Christian. Shut up. Ooh. You're like, aren't you saved? Like, don't you have any joy in your salvation? Oh, forget that. I forgot about that. You need to pray, restore unto me that joy. Because that joy makes us feel great. Even now, can you feel joy even when your circumstances are terrible? I mean, bad times hit. Can you still have joy in your heart? The joy of your salvation. Can you hold on to that? Yes. And some people, this is where love really shines the best as a Christian. When your neighbors are watching you go through bad circumstances and you still have joy. They're like, how can they have joy? Everything's hit the fan. I mean, they're losing their car got crunched in an accident and they're, you know, they got health problems. And you're still sitting there going, yeah, but I'm saved. My sins are forgiven. And that just boggles their mind. Like, how can you still be happy? Well, you're happy not because you're happy. You're joyful. It looks like happiness, but it's caused by what? That inner part of your soul is right with God. And Paul writes the church. And he says, rejoice in English, you say, which is literally the word to rejoy. You have joy, now do it again. You know, whenever you redo something, it's keep it up, right? Rejoice. How often should we rejoice anyway? You guys know the verse in Philippians 4:4? Rejoice in the Lord always, right? Again, I say rejoice. We used to sing that song all the time. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say. Now, you can rejoice in the Lord always. Can you rejoice always in your circumstances? No. So the source of my joy has to be the Lord. Love to be without hypocrisy means I got to really keep a focus on him. I mean, this is where the source of real love without hypocrisy comes from. It's from God. You know what is it? First John wrote, God is love. In him, there's no darkness at all. He's light. This is the source of all we're talking about comes from him. But we have to keep our focus on him. Well, I get to rejoice in the Lord always. And I need this joy. I tell you why I need it. Nehemiah wrote this in chapter 8, verse 10. He said, "The joy at the end of verse 10 says, the joy of the Lord is your what? Your strength. You guys have heard that, right? The joy of the Lord is your strength. Without joy, we lose our strength really quick. Christians, they peter out. You know, we got some young ones going to be going on outreach for YWAM. We got Mac here. Are you going also? You just got back. Okay. How important is it for us to keep the joy of the Lord when we serve Him in the mission field? Because that's our source of strength. We're going to call him up at the end and pray over him that he's leaving us this Tuesday, right, to go on outreach. So anyone else going? Sometimes we have a bunch of them. This quarter we got just a few, but we got some good ones. So we're really grateful that these guys are going to go be a light for the Lord. But, you know, when you don't keep him as your focal point, your source, you lose your joy. You lose your strength. Without joy, without rejoicing, you don't have strength. There's nothing, you know, and I'm talking about spiritual strength, that stamina that says keep going, you know. Yeah, how many Christians you run into, they start off really strong years ago. They're really into the faith. And then you talk to them today, and they're like, I don't go really that often. Once in a while, you know. Not really into it anymore. Why? You don't need forgiveness anymore? You don't need the Lord to help you anymore? I mean, has anyone here ever outgrown God's, you know, need for God's help? Anyone here been in Christ more than 10 years? Raise your hand. Just curious. Look at that. It's been preaching to the choir here. Do you outgrow needing the Lord when you get 10 years old in Christ? How about 20 years? Anyone 20 years or more? Look at that. 40. Oh. Gee, I'm only 35 years in the Lord. I can tell you, 35 years in the Lord. All I can tell you is I found out I need him more now than when I started. And I needed him a lot when I started. So let's just put it in, you know, real terms here. You don't outgrow your need for the Lord. And you don't outgrow that real source that we have to focus on him so we can have that joy of our salvation, so we can have our strength, so we can rejoice in the Lord always, even when our circumstances are terrible and we can't rejoice in them. See, this is where my Christian faith really shines, is if I rejoice in the Lord even when my circumstances aren't good. Because do your Christian friends watch you then? They're like, Hawkeye, you know? Man, watching you, you're like, God. They're just like everything I do. And yeah. And here, I love what Paul tells as the thing we're to rejoice. Now, he said rejoice in the Lord in Philippians. That's Philippians 4:4. But here in Romans 12:12, he says to rejoice in something else. Something else so precious, I think it's got to get put on the same shelf. This really an important one for our faith. This is to make it without love, without hypocrisy. We have to rejoice in what does it say? In hope. I just cracked up. I had the radio on. I'm driving, just running errands the other day, and the guy in the Christian radio station says, today's verse is Romans 12:12. Rejoice in the constant hope, persevere in your tribulations, and continue to be steadfast in prayer. That's a different translation than mine, but still covers the idea pretty solid. And I'm like, he's cheating. I'm teaching on that this Sunday, you know. And like two or three times when I was in the car, just different random times, the same little blurb came on the radio this week, you know. Rejoice in the constant hope. Or from the Hebrew, rejoice always in hope. Now, what is hope? I mean, what is the hope that God gives us? We have a hope. In fact, I don't know if you guys remember this verse, but Peter, when he was talking about how it's God's will that none should perish. Remember that? He says, but it's God's will that all would come to salvation through repentance. God wants everybody in the club. He loves us all. I know that really messes with some people's mind. They're like, even the bad guys? I'm like, who do you think's writing this thing? I mean, was Paul always a nice guy? You study the Bible, right? His name was Saul before. And he was out killing Christians. And God goes, he's got a lot of zeal. It's just misdirected. Pack. Blinds him. 3 days he gets led by the hand in the city. And it says, and he gets a personal talking to from the Lord. The Lord says, Saul, Saul, why dost thou persecute me? And he comes back really quick. oh, who art thou, Lord, that I might serve thee? You know, as he's blind there on the ground. And it says the men that were with him, they all heard the voice. They didn't get to see the thing what he saw, the light, the brightness of the Lord, but it blinded him. And they had to lead him by the hand. And it says in the book of Acts that the Lord Jesus told him, starting right then, hey, welcome to the club. Now I'm going to show you what you're going to suffer for my namesake. You caused a lot of suffering, but you're going to suffer now. Some people are like, don't tell people we're going to suffer as Christians. That's not really good. You're not going to get a big following, you know. Pastor, people aren't going to really come out for your church. You need to tell them what they want to hear. It's going to build up your self-esteem, and you're going to have a wonderful life, and it's going to be a bed of roses with no thorns. And I'm like, baloney. If anybody preaches you that gospel, that's a lie. That's a false gospel. Jesus said, in this world, you will have thorns from roses. In this world, you shall have, what's he say? Tribulation. But be of good cheer. He says, I have overcome the world. So I know we're going to have tribulation. And I don't think it's bad to tell new Christians when they join the club, get ready for the roller coaster ride. You know, when I baptize people, I bring them up out of the water and tell them, listen, welcome to the club and just get ready for the attacks. Because be realistic. How many of you experienced attacks of your faith right after you joined up? You came in the club and your friends like, you're not going to get all holy on us, are you? You're not going to go all religious nut, are you? And they start persecuting you because you're just happy that your sin got washed away. And all of a sudden, you feel this joy that is just, I mean, beyond all words. I mean, there's no way to even describe. You're trying to tell your family, you don't get it. I'm forgiven, and it feels good. And they're like, I don't feel that. Well, dude, ask for it, you know? No, I ain't doing that. And then they're going to test you and poke you and prod you for you feeling so good. How dare you feel good when they don't feel good? And they start giving you hassle. Peter went on to write something. I think it's really important that we take these words to heart. In 1 Peter, what was it? Is it first or second? Give me a second. I know it's on the right side of the... Oh, here. 1 Peter 3, 15. I should probably start at verse 13. Who is there to harm you if you prove zealous for good? But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, Peter says you're blessed. And don't fear their intimidation, and don't be troubled. You know, he's quoting Isaiah there, chapter 8. He says, don't fear when you're persecuted because of your faith. But sanctify Christ as Lord in your heart. And always be ready to make a defense or give an answer to everyone who asks you. To give an account for the hope that is in you. Yet with gentleness and reverence, he says. And keep a good conscience. But let's go back to Peter here. Peter says to be ready, to always be able to, I like the King James says, to be able to give an answer. An answer. Now, an answer implies that somebody did something. What does it imply? Somebody asked, right? This is something that I find sometimes as zealous new Christians, they want to thump people with the gun. You got to join the club because I'm in. Now you need to get in. And they weren't asking to get in. They weren't even asking a question at all. But they're going to force the answer on this person even though they weren't asking. I found it's much more effective to give an account of the hope that lies within my heart, an answer for that hope, whenever someone asks me. But see, in order for them to really want to ask me, I got to be living it. I got to be doing love without hypocrisy in a way that they see something in me and they're like, what is that? How come you have such joy and you even have hard things going on? How do I get that? When they ask, how do I get that? Or what is that? This is your 1 Peter 3:15 moment. Now you can give an answer to whoever asks of the account of your hope that it lies within you. And you give this answer with gentleness and with reverence. There's conditions. You don't give this answer harshly or, hey, stupid, don't you know I'm a Christian? You should be in the club too. You're screwed up. You need it. I mean, ask my wife. I used to do that. I wasn't known for being the most tactful Christian. I'm like, look, I know screwed up. I was there. You're it. You need to change, you know, and ask her. I did it. Not exactly with gentleness and reverence there. But I'm learning, okay? I'm working in progress. Like all of us, we're works in progress, right? But it says, be ready to give an account of what? Of the hope that lies within. What hope do we have? What is the hope of us Christians? I mean, collectively, of all Christians, we all have one singular hope. Eternal life. You know, comes when it's boiled down to the really basics of our faith, isn't it that we have the hope of everlasting life? I mean, yeah, we get our sins forgiven, but that's just the condition, what is required for us to enter into everlasting life. I mean, if our sin was with us, would we have everlasting life? Because what's the wages of sin? Death. So, bottom line, all Christians are in the club, basically, so we can get everlasting life. That's our hope. So when someone says, man, you seem to live differently. You seem to have this joy. You seem to have this light. You seem to have some life that I don't have. What is it? What is that? What is that all about? Don't pussyfoot around and go around the block with a bunch of different things. Just say, it's because I have the hope of everlasting life. And that hope is real. You know, hope is a powerful thing. Hope. We discount it. Paul says, rejoice in hope. Sometimes we forget what hope we have. And we lose our joy. And we lose our strength. And, you know, a hopeless Christian is really not my favorite ones to hang out with. When they lose that hope, they're just like, nah, 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 nah. And you're like, don't you get it? We get to rejoice in hope. We get to do this over and over, rejoice in hope. We get to revisit this hope. And by the way, I think it's a really good thing for all Christians to have a very, I don't know, repeatable schedule that revisits the idea that you got saved. You know, like in the Jewish culture, when God did some great deliverance. Remember when he brought Joshua across the Jordan after he took over from Moses? And you know, God is going to raise Joshua up as the next leader. So the Lord says, Joshua, have the priests put the ark on their shoulders and wade into the Jordan, and I will make the waters part. And do you guys remember? Everyone knows the story where Moses put the staff and touched the sea and the waters parted. But for God to make, you know, Moses' successor? Is that the right word? The guy comes after him, to kind of make him elevated in the eyes of the people, they needed to see that God was with him as much as he was with Moses. So Joshua, you know, kind of like the guy that was the undershadow to Moses those 40 years in the wilderness, now God's going, you're up, buddy. And when he gets the job, God says, okay, tell the priest, go into the river. What happened when the priest's feet touched the water? Do you guys remember the story? There in Joshua, their feet go into the water, and the water, it says, of the Jordan, heaped up on the one side, and on the other side, went dry. And the whole of the Israelites, the priests had to stand out in the middle of the riverbed with the ark, and they all passed by on dry ground as they entered into the promised land. And then the Lord did something we need to pay attention to. He said, each one of you elders from each of the 12 tribes, go back and at the place where the feet of the priests are standing, go get one of those river stones. Pick up a big one and bring it with us. And they go a whole day's journey into Canaan's land. They get to this place called Ai, and the Lord says, put those stones in a big pile. Make a little pyramid, you know, little pile of river stones. And when the kids, this is the middle of the desert. I don't know if you guys have been to Israel, but this is like way out in the desert. When your children and your children's children and their children ask, what are those stones, like river stones, doing out in the middle of the desert? You are to tell them That is when the Lord did a mighty thing and brought us out of the wanderings we were in into his promised land. You need to remember the mighty things what God has done. You know what? I think we need to schedule in a reminder of maybe it was the day you got saved. Maybe you need a spiritual birthday party. I mean, we do physical birthday parties. Why don't we do spiritual birthday parties? You know, just like a annual reminder of, hey, I really got in the club. Guys, I'm going to have a party. Everyone coming over. We're gonna celebrate that I got born again. I mean, we celebrate when we were born physically, but how about when we were born spiritually? And I think we need to be reminded because it's the hope we have of everlasting life, and we forget really quick. We're like, I got busy. Don't really remember, you know. And then as soon as we lose that hope, we're like, it reminds me of this, when I was a young student at Arizona State, the professor was talking about how strong this intangible things can be. It was a psych class, mandatory. I hated that class. Sorry, I just... And he's like, well, one of the studies done, and if you're an animal lover, you're not going to like this story too much. Well, maybe you might, because they use rats. And they put them in these tubes, these slippery tubes, with water. And they timed how long they would swim before they'd give up. And they just to let you know, this is college. Okay, back then, they were like, we're going to get a statistical large group of drowned rats to make sure that, you know, that we get a really good statistical data. How long can a rat swim before it gives up and drowns? And so they did it. I mean, they drowned like 10,000 rats. Now, some of you are going, praise God. You know, I hate those things. But this college, you know, and it wasn't my college, so don't get mad at me. We didn't do it. We just heard about the study, okay? You could probably look it up on Google now. But they timed the rats, how long they swam. And then they took a group of these rats, and they had the students waiting around the little things. And when the rat, you know, they kind of, I can't remember what it was. They could swim like a pretty long, 6-8 hours they would go before they would give up and, you know, just quit swimming and drown. And so what they did is they had the lab students standing around with towels, little snacks for the rats and stuff, and they were to wait until the rat started to go down and then reach in and pull it out and dry it off and feed it and pamper it. And you go, what? Wait, this gets better. Then they took the same rat the next day and threw him back in the water. And they timed how long it swam. And at whatever 6 or 8 hours, whatever the time was that they usually give up, the rat started looking up, waiting for someone to rescue it. And when the rat started to slow down, all the student would have to do is peek over the little lip, and the rat would look up, oh, you're there, and keep swimming. And these rats that only swam for 6 to 8 hours wound up swimming for like 3 days straight with just the power of this. Someone looking down and them looking up for hope. You go, how powerful is hope? When you're in a bad circumstance, is it important that we have hope? I mean, you hear these survival stories on the television where the one person had hope that they were going to be rescued and the other person gave up. And the person who gave up, they like give up right 10 minutes before the rescue happened, right? And they die. And you're like, tragic. But that's what Christian life is like when we don't hold on to the hope that we have. We forget. And we all have the hope of everlasting life. We should be hanging on to that. And when people go, how do you keep going? I mean, you're like swimming in a torrent of just getting pounded, and you're like, it's okay. Because I'm looking up, because I know there's somebody looking over the lip going, I got you. And that's the Lord. I mean, if a rat can do that long, how about us as Christians? Do we really rejoice in the hope what we are given? Well, I should probably stop right there, because there's all that persevering in tribulation yet to do. And then there's the being devoted to prayer thing. That's a whole sermon, don't you think? Do we really devote ourselves to prayer, a prayer life in today's Christian circles? Like they do in the Korean church where they know that they can be killed at any moment for their faith. You know, I hear that the Korean church, they don't even have to teach them to pray. They do it all the time. In fact, they go to church and they don't know if that's their last service. They start with like 2 hours of prayer at the Korean church services. People come and just fall on their face and pray. And they don't know if they'll be killed. They don't know if there's someone barge in and say, oh, you Christians gather, you're not allowed to, we're killing you. Being persecuted for their faith. And now the president over there has got a nuke. And I think he's got the same crazy spirit that Mussolini had. You know, I do believe that there are principalities and powers and spiritual forces of wickedness at work. And I don't think they're new. I mean, you look at Hitler and Mussolini, and I can only use him because he was Italian, you know. Cuckoo. He had an evil spirit on him. I think the same spirit migrated over to North Korea. It's right, North Korea, right? It's the one that's got the... Is it South or North? North. That's right, North Korea. And that guy's got the same... Wants to kill the Christians, wants to... I mean, there's some crazy hate going on. I don't think we really got much slack on this thing. We got to really love without hypocrisy if we're going to be a light for the Lord. So this week, would you do me a favor? If you can remember the day when you found out Christ forgave you, and you remember that feeling, how good it felt, that joy that you felt like. Now, if you've never experienced it, you need to come see me afterwards. I'll pray with you. So this will be the day that you get to remember. Okay, we'll make today, you know, the scripture says today is a good, acceptable day for salvation. I mean, this is the day. Don't put it off. Don't be one of those guys, yeah, pastor, I've heard this before. I'm going to do it later. You know, we don't have guarantees for later. Do it now. Give your life to the Lord now. Get your forgiveness now. And then you can start rejoicing in the hope that all the rest of us get to rejoice in all week long. But the rest of you, do me a favor. Just with your mind, you know, waking up, start off your week this week going, Lord, thanks for saving me. I know it sounds too simple, but trust me on this one. If you just revisit that in your mind, that it's like the Israelites looking at the stones going, wow, God did a miracle and brought me into his promises. He brought me out of wanderings into a place that he has. Does he do that for us spiritually when he forgives us? Sure. But we forget. We need to get a little pile of rocks. One that we go trip over. Oh yeah, that's right. See that again and remind myself, I'm saved. Lord, thank you for forgiving me of my sins. Just start off your week this week, every morning. Lord, thank you for that day. Let that day come back into my consciousness so that I could have your joy. Restore, like David said, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. May you get to experience that prayer in a deeper way than you ever have. Like, own it for yourself this week. Make it your own, not like, yeah, that's what David prayed. How about let's make it what we pray? We'll just go, Lord, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Make me have your joy like I did when I first learned you forgave me. Because some of the older Christians here, they just need to revisit that. To pump them back up, you know, kind of reinvigorate them. Get them back to that sweet part what we were designed for. And then your friends will see something in you. They'll be like, that guy, man, I want what he had. How did you get that, Carl? They'll be like, tell me where you got that. And you'd be like, oh, it's a real simple prayer. Just ask God to forgive you. And then remember that day that he forgave you. Because that day just can stick with you and bring your joy back up to full. Your joy meter will be reading real high. And you'll be rejoicing in the hope, that constant hope that we have as Christians. Next week, I'm not making any promises, but I'll try to make it through the rest of this paragraph. It ends at verse 13. Woo! Inching through the word. My wife says, that should be the name of the radio program instead. Inching through the word with Pastor Izzy. Sorry, I like this stuff. There's some really good stuff in here for our faith. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, thanks so much for your word. Thank you for the admonishments it gives us so we can walk in a way that you desire for us to walk. I just pray as we go from here that you let these words just sink into our hearts, our minds, deep into our souls, Lord, that our spirits would be reinvigorated. We would be reminded of the great work what you did to forgive us. Lord, I know I'm so grateful that you would forgive me, Lord, my sins. And Lord, I know if you'd forgive me, you could forgive anyone. Lord, I just pray for those that haven't tasted of that sweet forgiveness. Today would be the day that they get to partake in your forgiveness for their sins. And Lord, for those of us that have already experienced it, Lord, let us revisit it today, tomorrow, through the whole of this next week, that we would have really a true rejoicing in your hope. And thank you for that hope, Lord. We give you thanks and praise. Go with us now. In your son's name we ask. In Christ's name we pray. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me, let's sing a closing song and send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.